Father, here he stands, your servant, coming to share your word with us. So Lord, fill his heart with your spirit, so that all may be heard that you wish us to hear. We ask these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
I just happen to have in my trunk my car, my robe, so. It is a privilege to preach. It is a privilege
to preach. And it is a privilege to preach to you, preachers. So my prayer for us tonight and for this conference is that we may find the time to rest, to reconcile, and to revive so that we may walk in beauty. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth, the meditations of all our hearts, be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. All things work together for the good. When they were filming The Wizard of Oz, they needed a long coat for Professor Marvel, who you remember was the person who became the wizard in Dorothy's dream. So the casting people went to a secondhand store in Los Angeles and found the perfect long robe. And if you go home and watch The Wizard of Oz, you will see that robe. Now, what's amazing about that robe is that they later found out and verified that it was once owned by L. Frank Baum, the author of The Wizard of Oz. It's called synchronicity. Coincidence! I like to think it's beautiful. How things work together for good. Or, as my friend Ben says, Ben runs our audiovisual at our church and he's Jewish. Ben says it's Tovey. Anyway, more about that later. God is called beautiful, okay? That's what our Song of Songs was about. It was about being beautiful. It isn't about beating yourself over the head with God, God, God. Song of Songs is about seeing that one and only, and I want you to do something for me. I want you to close your eyes and think about that one and only. I want you to think about your one and only. I want you to see the subtle beauty of God, whose image she or he was created. Now open your eyes, we'll talk more about that later. Tonight's about rest for the weary and health for us all. Come unto me, all ye who are weary and heavy laden, I will give you rest. And you know, when you talk about rest in the church, you can't help thinking about the 6 days we were given to do our work and that blessed one day to rest. Perfect rest. And after 6 days of working, I'll tell you that one day of rest is great. If 6 days are good, how much gooder is that one day? It's sort of like a cool beverage after mowing the lawn for hours. You know what I'm saying? I mean, you have to mow the lawn and it takes a long time, but sometimes that cold beverage just does it. Or maybe it's hot chocolate after a day of tobogganing. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Or how about this? Cool sheets after a hot bath. Philip Melanchthon, the great Reformation theologian, once said to his good buddy Martin Luther, "This day you and I will discuss the governance of the universe," to which Luther replied to his friend, "This day you and I will go fishing and leave the governance of the universe to God." Rest, rest, rest. Beautiful. Trouble is, we get that 6 day work stuff and we get too busy with it. We forget about the one day stuff. Our Jewish sisters and brothers have it right. They treat the Shabbat like Loverboy does. Everybody's working for the weekend. Right? The Shabbat is part of it all. It's the point of it all. You work so you can have Sabbath. You have Sabbath so you can work. It goes together like peas and carrots. Hand in glove. You can't have one without the other. That's the way God made things. Male and female, we created them. We don't need each other. There's a bit of graffiti on the wall, the rec hall Reno Hill Camp, a Unite Church camp I have been associated with since I was 16 years old. And it haunts me to this day. I think it's because I love canoeing. I've never been so happy as the day of my wife said, go buy a canoe. Anyway, the quote has to do with the ordinary workaday paddle stroke of canoeing, and everybody knows it's the J stroke. And the quote goes, the J stroke, which involves both forward and backward movement of the paddle, is the perfect balance between the past and the future. Too much emphasis on either ruins progress, but just the right combination of pressure sends the canoe gliding gracefully through the present. I thought it was just me who had this stuff figured out about the J-stroke. Picture that. Early morning, mist coming off the lake, sitting just a few centimeters before, over top of that lake surface, the dragonflies darting around you, like the Spirit of God hovering over the waters of creation's birth. But David McFarland also died. He's the author of the book Summer Gone. And it's a book about summer things, like knots and canoes and boys and girls. And one of his characters, the camp counselor, talks to his campers. And he says to them, guys, at the most basic level, there are two forces at work when you paddle a canoe. There's the forward stroke of propulsion and the backward stroke of course correction. That's it. Positive force and a negative force. One to push you forward, the other to pull the canoe back on course. And the trick, the real trick, of course, is to find balance by combining the two. Balance. Synchronicity. Rest. Beauty. There's a time for everything. There's a season for everything. I've read the Tony Hillerman books, the Cheam and Leaphorn novels of the Diné of the American Southwest. Hillerman is a great ethnographer as well as a great mystery writer. And he talks about the Diné, the Navajo, as we know them as, and they talk about this balance of beauty and life as chuzwa, the walking in beauty. And so the goal of life for the Navajo is to walk in beauty, to be in beauty all the time. And so everything in life is connected to everything else. A stone thrown into a pond affects the owl in the forest. A word spoken at crucifixion affects people around the globe. We know that, don't we? When we pray, it has power to it. And so the DNA's trying to live their life in harmony and balance. So their belief system sees sickness as a result of falling out of that balance. Sin is of one's losing one's way on the path of beauty. And so Gloria Davis, a sister of the Blessed Sacrament, who teaches Native spirituality in New Mexico, her notions of this spirituality formed when she was growing up in that traditional Navajo community of hers. She once wrote, I noticed that the holy people in our community, the ones we turn to for spiritual guidance, who conducted the blessing and healing ceremonies, were always the people with the keenest sense of humor. You can spot the holy people by the laughing that's around. Holiness, I think we know, is not turning away from the world, but diving into life. And rest, pure, true rest, is that point of being when your feet leave the diving board and before your head hits the water. Beauty and rest are a result of this. It's an everyday goofy sense of humor, which is home from life. The ups and downs of life, the good and the bad, the sorrows and the absurdities, the peculiar and the perplexed. But seeing beauty in all things has never been easy for us, nor has it been seen as important by us Christians. We're so busy worrying about morality and judgment and justice that we forget about beautiful, and that's where that word tove comes from. From the story of creation, good. You see, God creates everything, doesn't God? Three-toed sloths, volcanoes, quasars, turkey vultures, you got it. And God says what? It's good. But the word in Hebrew is tove. And I love that word because it comes from right here. Tove. You got to think about, what's his name from Fiddler on the Roof? Tevye. Tove. But a lot of people through the years have interpreted that good of creation as a moral thing. Like how to obey laws. Good. And how you have to be a good little boy or little girl. But the thing is that tove, good, connotes aesthetics rather than acts. So when God created everything, he called it beautiful. Beautiful. Not perfect, but working together. Beautiful. So when God calls something beautiful, like my teenage daughters who can't see it themselves, when God says they're beautiful, when God says they're good, they are beautiful. It's not a moral judgment, but aesthetic. It's not right or wrong, but beautiful. So sin comes from not right or wrong, but lacking in harmony. Or making things ugly. I don't know, maybe the sermon is too much sex, drugs, and rock and roll. I mean, we heard about fawny breasts in our scripture lesson. How many of you would have the guts to preach that sermon? Yeah, I know, Ricky, yeah. And then 10 members have been standing would be meeting after the service. I guess what I'm saying is that, like Aslan mentioned, is that there's a deeper magic. I think there's a deeper beauty underlying our lives. And it has to do with things like, yes, fawny breasts and beautiful lips and hair. But it also has to do with something, and if you get a chance to look it up, something that comes from our Japanese brothers and sisters, wabi-sabi. It's that beautifully, perfectly manicured lawn with cherry blossoms sprinkled on it. Beautiful is a 90-year-old faces with lap frills. Beautiful is that Father's Day cup on your desk filled with pens and pencils that's chipped and has followed you from manse to manse. That means more than anything else in the house. That seems like the gospel to me. And when we feel spiritually tired and ugly and morally decrepit, we turn to a Savior who has gunger, as some, makes beautiful things out of what Isaiah says, the ugly, terrible rags of our lives. Because that Savior's been with us the whole time. He's lived the life. He knows that with the ugliness of our fallen nature shines the beauty of our creation and redemption. And like all beauty, and my beautiful girls, it's in the eyes not of the beholder, but of the Creator. One of the most powerful commercials I ever saw, it didn't have a word to it. You can go on YouTube and find it. It's hard to find now, but it came out about 10, 15 years ago. And it simply shows a series of people, athletes, with one thing in common, a nasty injury on their body. A cowboy with a huge scar on his face and his eyes going in different directions. A boxer with a broken nose. A runner with horribly calloused feet. Anybody who runs marathons knows about those feet. Or a ballet dancer. Hey, Lori? Finally, the ad ends with a hockey player who just looks at you and then all of a sudden his face splits into a grin and like Chris Neal from the Ottawa Senators, which is what every hockey player had ever played, that gapless smile. And then underneath it is that swoosh from Nike that says, just do it. And the ad has been analyzed and criticized as being incomprehensible or extreme. But the key to its It's a controversial commercial lies in the music that plays while these images of these horribly mutilated people go through. You see, Joe Cocker, that unexpected rock star who just died a couple of months ago, sings, "You are so beautiful to me." As you're watching the wrestler with his cauliflower ear, and the surfer with the shark bite on her side, the bull rider blind in one eye, their injuries are beauty marks because they have fought the good fight. And those who aspire to it see the beauty in it. And I can't help but think that as God looks down on us, miserable worms, sinners all, spending too much time fishing and not enough time contemplating the governance of the universe, as broken ones with mastectomy scars and scars on our wrists, maybe on our hands and feet, and maybe it's God speaking to us. A soul in our ears whispering, "You are so beautiful to me." And so I'm going to ask you to stand. And in one of the rituals of the Diné of the Navajo, in beauty may I walk. All day long may I walk. Through the returning seasons, may I walk. On the trail marked with pollen, may I walk. With grasshoppers above my feet, may I walk. With dew above my feet, may I walk. With beauty, may I walk. With beauty before me, may I walk. With beauty behind me, may I walk. With beauty above me, may I walk. With beauty below me, may I walk. With beauty all around me, may I walk. In old age wandering on the trail of beauty, lively may I walk. In old age wandering on the trail of beauty, living again, may I walk. It is finished in beauty. It is finished in beauty.